Stuff these days, everyone. Are we on now? We're on. Fantastic. Good morning. Right. It's chaos here today, but we don't mind. Welcome to Medhead Christian Fellowship. I'm Jonathan, and I'll be leading the service this morning. It's lovely to have you with us, if you're watching online or here in the building. We're here to worship the Lord and to give Him our best this morning as we focus upon Him. We're going to start, as we normally do in this church, with a reading. So if you're able to stand and willing to stand, perhaps you might want to join me and say these words that are written by Paul to Timothy in a letter right at the beginning of chapter 1 of 1 Timothy. Let's read these words together. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that He considered me faithful, appointing me to His service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display His unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on Him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's just pray. So wonderful words. Often we come to church and we feel pretty unworthy and pretty dirty and pretty unclean. What Paul tells us here is that, you know, there was a time when he was like that, but God met him and God changed his life and God made a difference in his life. That can be true for each one of us in this room this morning, as we open up our lives to Him. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. However dirty or disheveled or hopeless or helpless we feel this morning, we know You are the God who comes close to us, the one who draws near, the one who sustains us, the one who helps us, the one who encourages us, the one who is with us. To this great God, we give thanks this morning, the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God. And as we worship You today, we say, be honoured and glorified among us. In Jesus' name, amen. Over to Chris, thanks. Morning, Chris.
I will worship.
I will follow all of Your ways. Place, Lord, have your way. Father, we call on your name this morning. Come like that rushing wind, Lord. Lord, fall in this place where your people are gathered to worship you. Oh, Jesus. 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 Praise your name, Father.
Jesus, thank you, Jesus.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun.
Chuck, you're needed. Come on, well, you wanted to give a testimony. Let's hear some good news. Thursday we had a team from the Message Trust here, and Phil had them with him on Thursday night. Yeah. That mic, I think, mate.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Well, I just want to share about Thursday nights and what is happening. It's absolutely fantastic what is happening. And Thursday, there was so much happening Thursday night. When I got home, I nearly jumped over our house. I was that are absolutely excited with what the Lord's doing. And last week I shared about, very often we it's like playing football in long grass. And we've been like that at our dropping for months sometimes. It was like trying to play football in long grass. You know what's happening now? Jesus, I'll end up crying, I know, because I'm so excited about it. Jesus is cutting the grass. He's cutting the grass. And before when we were in long grass, somebody would come for a week, then they'd miss a week, they'd come next week. You know, now Jesus is cutting grass, they don't want to miss. Because they're going to miss something if they miss. That's fantastic. Just them will pray for us. Thank you for it. I really appreciate that. Because God is moving. On Thursday, we had, some of you have probably heard them, but we had four young people sent to us by Jonathan. Yeah. And I was thinking, I don't know how it's going to work, you know. Because people come, they like playing pool and darts and all this. How's it going to work to introduce some singers? Anyway, when they come, really nice people. So what we said to them was, right, you've got from half eight till 9 o'clock. See what you can do. I'm not kidding. Forgive me, Lord, for limiting them to half an hour. I'm not kidding. They were singing about being in love with Jesus in a rap, Christian rap. I wish I could do it to show you. It was phenomenal. And then one did a little talk and he's asking for hands to go up and all that. And I'm thinking, I don't think that's going to happen here. And it didn't happen. But you know, afterwards, I'm looking around afterwards. There's people praying for people. This one guy come to me and says, somebody's just given me a word about me being in the stream of the Holy Spirit. And he says, I had that word 2 months ago. So these young people are moving in the Holy Spirit. And I'm looking around, honestly, I'm jumping over the house again. And also, at 12 o'clock at night, somebody's being prayed for. They don't want to go home. We're still standing outside till 12 o'clock. Somebody were asking the Lord into his life. Brilliant. And this guy's a big fish, let me tell you. He's a big fish. He's been checking some all in him for months. And he broke his heart. And he wants to get baptized. So we've got to book a baptism, mate.
We'll do it
soon.
Promise, Bob.
Yeah. That's great. I don't know if I'm allowed to say, but I wish Jesus had cut the grass at Bramall Lane yesterday. Sheffield United looked like they were playing in long grass all the match. Oh, dear. Well, never mind. We'll move on quickly. Notice this. Just to say, welcome visitors. We do have a visitors pack, which I forgot to pick up today in the foyer, which tells you all the things that are happening here during the week. And there's a lot. So please pick hold of one of those if you want to. 4 o'clock this afternoon, hear good things about the service that's happening at 4 o'clock. More and more people are coming to that, so that's really good news. So pray for Catherine and the team at 4 this afternoon. There'll be a WhatsApp prayer meeting at 7:30 tonight. For those of you who don't know, we have a food, we work with a local food bank in partnership here, but we've also got our own clothes bank that Ange runs called Lily's Clothes Bank, and they need some summer clothes. So if you've got any summer clothes that you can donate, that would be great. Another sign of the generosity of this church, we're overwhelmed, so grateful, was the CLC missions offering last week, which amounted to £1,564.44. So thank you, everyone. You'll be hearing a little bit about where that's going later. Also, we need to remember in our prayers, we'll do more of this tonight, Aidan's on this missions trip to Kenya. Jakey's brother who doesn't come here, but Nick and Erica's son. He's on his second trip out to Ukraine at the moment, taking out another vehicle. They're on the way at the moment, so remember to pray for them. And also people like Graham and Steph, obviously, in Zambia, and Olivia, who's out working for the Lord. I won't say where she is. Actually, I can say she's in Yemen, because nobody who's not Olivia is, do you, on the internet? No. Don't know her surname. That's great. Anyway, now we're just going to listen to a story on the family slot, please, if we can. Thank you.
The long meeting. Last week, we heard how God had shown Peter that Jesus hadn't come to save the Jews, but they'd come to save everyone, even you. Today's story takes place about 10 years after Peter had met Cornelius. Two disciples, called Paul and Barnabas, had been on a journey through Cyprus and what we now know as Turkey. Afterwards, they went back to their home church in Antioch in Cilicia and told them about everything that God had done. Whilst they were there, some Jewish believers who had been Pharisees travelled to Antioch. They were saying some dodgy stuff. They started telling people that they could only really become Christians and be saved if they became Jews as well and followed all the Jewish laws that Moses set out. This was very different to what Paul and Barnabas believed, and so there was a bit of discussion. In fact, there was actually quite a big argument. Could anyone be saved by just believing in Jesus and turning away from sin, or did they need to become Jews as well? They could not agree. Both sides were not willing to accept each other's point of view. Both sides were thinking that they were right and the other one was wrong. We've all been there. This went on for a while, a long while. Eventually, the church in Antioch decided to send Paul, Barnabas, and some other men to Jerusalem to meet with the apostles and the council there. They needed the Holy Spirit's wisdom and guidance before. Everyone started falling out with each other and spoiling the church. When they got to Jerusalem, Paul and Barnabas got such a welcome. Everyone was really pleased to see them, and they enjoyed hearing about everything that God had been doing in Cyprus and Turkey, and about how many people were believing in Jesus. Then the men from the Pharisees group stood up and started saying, "This is all very well, but these Gentiles, believers, that aren't proper Christians, they don't follow the Jewish rules, and that's not right. They shouldn't be part of the church until they become Jews and start doing things properly." So the elders and apostles, they were some of the original 12 disciples, had a meeting. They had a very long discussion. Several people talked, some for longer than others. Peter stood up and reminded them of what had happened 10 years earlier when he met Cornelius, or for us, last week. How God had filled the Gentiles in Caesarea with his Holy Spirit, and how God has shown him then that God wants everyone to be saved and doesn't treat people any differently, whether they follow Jewish laws or not. The Holy Spirit came on the believers, Jews and Gentiles, in the same way. Paul and Barnabas stood up and told everyone how they preached to the Gentiles and how God had done miracles and works amongst them. Then James, one of Jesus' younger brothers, who was quite wise, stood up and reminded them of the old prophecies, the ones that said God will make a way for all people from all nations to come and worship him. He said, "It seems obvious that that's been happening, so I think we shouldn't make it difficult for Gentiles to be saved. We don't need to teach the Gentiles they should leave their cultures and become Jews to follow Jesus, but there are some things we should all do. Let's write a letter to the church in Antioch outlining the things that both Jews and Gentiles should do." So that is what they did. Now, there were no emails or mobile phones or phone calls in those days, so they got out a scratchy pen and parchment and wrote a letter saying that believers shouldn't eat certain foods and why they shouldn't eat or drink blood. Yuck. And that they should stay faithful to their wives and husbands. And of course, to follow the teachings of Jesus, to love God and to love our neighbours. So that was that. It was sorted. They wrote the letter probably a few times to get the words right. And then, as there was no postman, Paul and Barnabas and some others had to deliver it themselves. These are hard-working guys. So they went back to the church in Antioch. When the believers heard their message, they were chuffed to bits. They hadn't been looking forward to some of those Jewish rules. The problem was sorted, and we didn't have to worry about becoming Jews to be saved. The message that Jewish believers brought was dodgy. It was dodgy because it added rule to the message of the gospel. People are only saved by faith in Jesus. Whatever culture or country they live in, we don't earn forgiveness by keeping rules. And that is great news.
Thank you. I once heard a guy called Dave Cave speaking on this passage that's from Acts 15, and he titled his talk, Bacon Butties Are Back On. And, essentially talking that the food laws are no longer there. I mean, essentially, this is a story about change, something that we're going to be going through, something that Rick, who's our speaker today, will be talking to us about, some of the changes we face in church and how we cope with change and how we understand how as Christians, we should work together to try and make change happen well. There was another sort of message I should have given. So if you're going out with the youth today, can I just make a polite message to you? It's from Go Ye Ministries. There's no loo in the library today for the youth group. So if you've got to go, you've got to go. But could you please go here before you go there? Because if you want to go when you're there, you won't be able to go there. You'll have to come back here to go. Does that make any sense? Brilliant. So we're just going to listen to Liz now. Liz, it works for CLC. She's got some news for us, and she's got a message for us about the missions offering we took last week, and perhaps something else as well. So we're just going to listen to that now, please.
Well, for me, it's a chilly good evening here in my friend's garden in North London, but I'm coming to say a very warm good morning to Pastor Jonathan and all my brothers and sisters in Meadowhead Christian Fellowship. And it's my tremendous pleasure to come as CLC Africa Regional Director once again. You can just about see the logo on the shirt here, covered up because it's a bit chilly now. Just to say thank you for another stupendous missions offering from you to us this past Sunday, 8th of May. Thank you very, very much for your generosity once again. I understand that the amount raised this time was £1,564 towards the new four-wheel drive for CLC Burkina Faso. So we're absolutely thrilled. And my lovely colleague Luke in Ouagadougou has written you a letter. And I'd like to read it for you now. This is a translation from the French. And he says this. Dear Pastor Jonathan Dunning, dear sisters and brothers of the Meadowhead Christian Fellowship, may the grace of God, the source of salvation manifested in Jesus Christ for the salvation of humanity, still rest abundantly on each and every one of you. We come with this message to say a big thank you and to express the gratitude of the CLC Burkina and the body of Christ in Burkina Faso for your hearts of love for the Lord Jesus Christ. It is his love in you that has moved you to so much kindness, generosity, compassion, and enormous sacrifice for CLC Burkina, and beyond it, all of Burkina Faso. On several occasions, you have let your heart speak, as in the case of the purchase of this vehicle, for which you have just donated the equivalent of £1,168,376 Central African francs. Obtaining this vehicle will allow us to bring literature to people who cannot come to our bookshop because they're in the interior of the country, far from the capital. Also, this vehicle will allow us to go to churches, to hold book stands, and to make book tables during conferences, seminars, and conventions. Once again, we thank you. And we leave you with this thought from the book of Hebrews, chapter 6, verse 10. For God is not unjust to forget your work and the love that you have shown for his name, having rendered and still rendering services to the saints. Mr. Nufe Samiluk, Director for CLC, Burkina Faso. Wow. And men ahead, please be assured that when we have the vehicle and it's in use there in Burkina, you are going to see what that looks like. I'd like to add my thanks again to those of Luke and Gerard and those in the ministry there. And before I leave you, I just have a little bit of personal news to share with you. I asked Pastor Jonathan if it would be okay for me to do that this morning. And he said, yes, please go ahead. So here we go. When I was with you in the month of March, and you very kindly prayed for me and my CLC colleague Petra, I shared with you that I'd narrowed down my shortlist of where to make my next base to two locations at that point. And one was Sheffield and the other Portugal. And I was spending the month of March in Sheffield and the month of April in Portugal to see what the Lord would say to my heart. And so having now completed both of those months and having had time to really seek the Lord in prayer, I am very excited to be sharing with you that over the next few weeks, as the Lord enables, I'm planning to move up to Sheffield. And I'm very much looking forward to being a part of Meadowhead Christian Fellowship. You blew me away with the warmth of your welcome and a whole host of other things when I was there in March. And I'm excited at the new adventure that the Lord will have for me in Sheffield soon. So God bless you, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Stay well and safe, and keep looking up. Bye-bye.
To let you know that Liz has also bought a house now. She put an offer in that was £4,000 less than the asking price, and she's got it. So she's moving up, won't be too far from here, walking distance from here. So pretty close to you, Howard, so cheer up. You'll have to behave yourself. Let's just pray for a couple of things then. If the musicians want to come to the stage at the same time while I'm praying, and then we'll take up the offering immediately, please, and then the children and the youth can go to wherever they need to go to first before they go to their venues. Okay, let's pray. Father, we thank you for Liz. Thank you for CLC. Thank you for this opportunity to hear this message back from Burkina Faso today and all the problems and persecution that they've suffered over there. Lord, we pray your blessing on Luke and the team and pray that this vehicle would be a great blessing to them. We pray for Aidan today, Lord, and we pray for Graham and Steph, and we pray for Livia. Lord, we ask your blessing upon them in all that they're doing also. We pray for Jake too and pray for safe travel for him as he goes out to Ukraine at this time. Lord, there's so many things that we're involved with in little ways around the world, but I thank you that our influence doesn't just extend to the edge of Bitmore Johnthorpe, but by the power of your Holy Spirit, you've enabled us to take your word across this world. And I pray, Lord, that generosity of spirit, that pioneering spirit, would remain strong in us in Jesus' name. Lord, bless us as we give now, and bless our worship, bless the children's work, the youth work, Lord. May all really have a tremendous time in getting to know you even better. In Jesus' name, amen. Chris. If you want to stand, please, if you can, and take up the offering immediately, please, those who are doing it. Actually, I haven't arranged for anyone to do it, and I don't even know where the offering bags are. So that's a really good start.
Normality resume.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything, and I will sing your praise. You shed your blood for me. What can I say? And you took my sin and shame, a sinner called by name. Grace.
Mount your glory, Almighty God, in every way. You are above and beyond understanding. We did not praise, the rocks would cry out. Glorious God, high above understanding. Vast expanse of earth and sea, held by you in harmony, speaks of your glory and all you've made since time began. Life itself, the perfect plan. God, in every way, you are above and beyond understanding. We did not praise, the rocks would cry out. Glorious God, high above understanding. Creation joins as one to sing. Understanding, we did not praise, the rocks will cry out. Glorious God, high above understanding. Almighty God, in every way, you are above and beyond understanding. We did not praise, the rocks will cry out. Glorious God, high above understanding.
Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Praise your name, Father. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Jesus. The highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring. Every creature unique in the song that is. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. An all-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing. Told every light move on where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun and gives source to the light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of. I'm not your
fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God.
Incomparable and unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same.
You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing,
just take a moment just to think about those words, the things that we can't fathom, that we trust God for every day of our lives, the things that we can't see that we trust God for, the things that he's revealing to us, like we heard from Phil this morning. Lord, we can't fathom this stuff, Lord, you can. Lord, and you are amazing. Jesus. Praise your name.
Last worship song about it's time for a spring clean, and I was thinking about the temple, and both in Hezekiah's day and certainly in Josiah's day, there was a sense of the people coming back to God and cleaning out the temple that had just got cluttered with other stuff. And it's particularly the Josiah thing reminded me that actually as they were doing that spring clean, that they discovered God's word. And I think for some of you, there are people perhaps listening, perhaps they're in this building, who you are struggling to receive or to hear God's word. But there's an attentiveness that needs to come into our life to the things that are happening in our own world, in our own lives, the things that are filling our minds, filling our lives, that actually clutter up our thinking and clutter up our actions. It's time for a spring clean, says God. It's time to cut the grass. It's time to actually get to a place from instead of being stuck where you will hear my word. My word is with you. My word is present in you. But in a sense, you know, the clutter has caused you to neglect and to not focus on what I would say to you. remove the clutter, have a spring clean, and hear God. Amen.
A thousand times I've still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all things. Will above of all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory knows the honor. In my heart and my soul, I give you. I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all things. Will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all things. In my heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. Love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out. From the inside out, Lord, my soul cries out.
From the inside out. What are you crawling out to God for? What are you calling out for? In our land, in our world, in this city, in our church, in our families, in our lives. Let justice and praise become our embrace. Lord, come.
Father, we cry out for peace, Lord, for Ukraine.
Yeah.
And that part of the world, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we cry out, Lord.
Yes.
Bring Jesus. Those nations down, Lord, that are causing this pain.
Yeah. Amen.
Lord Jesus, bring down the evil that exists in those places, Lord, that are causing Lord. This pain and destruction, Father. And bring peace, Lord. Lord, let your spirit come in that place, Lord. And for those people who are suffering today, yeah. Lord, we just pray for that peace to overwhelm them, Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
Lord, call on us to do what we can do.
Yes. Jesus.
Jesus. Peace, Lord Jesus.
Lord, I pray you'd visit this city with your salvation. Pray you visit our lives and our families with your salvation. Visit this area with your salvation. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus. Yes.
Rejoice before him.
Yeah.
His name is the Lord.
Hallelujah.
A father to the fatherless. Mm-hmm. A defender of widows is God in his holy dwelling. God sets the desolate in a homeland.
Mm.
He leads out the prisoners with singing, but the rebellious live in a sun scorched land.
Yeah, Lord. Come, Lord. Come, Lord.
Father, I pray that as people come into this building, they will actually feel what I felt this morning, which was walking into your presence.
Mm.
Those that are not saved, Lord, those that are on the edge, that they come in or they're brought in as guests. Father, that they would feel what I felt this morning,
yes,
which
thank
was your
you,
Holy
Lord.
Spirit
yeah.
being there, welcoming, engulfing. Mm-hmm. It was just such a wonderful thing, Lord. And I just pray that for yeah. anybody that comes in.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
We pray for those Ukrainians taken prisoner, Lord. Mm. Taken to Russia. Lord, the thousands of them, we pray that you will
Lord, have mercy.
Yes,
Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Father, just as we feel your presence here, I pray that we would be presence carriers and that we would be able to take you out to the people that we see.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Would experience you through us.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
And we just ask that you would make us more effective in that.
Mm. Yes.
Fill us afresh in your Holy Spirit to
yes,
be your people wherever you've put us.
Yes, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Let's just all raise our voices to God now. Let's just praise God together. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Mighty God. Mighty God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, Father. Yeah.
Holy.
Jesus, come, Lord. Come, Lord. Come by. Come in power, Lord. Kiana morustara barashtika kara. Come by your Spirit, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Kia kara stura barashtika kara. Bless you, Jesus. Kiana morustura sta kaba barashtia kara marasta. Jesus. Yamurus to Kababara Staraya Karashi Karashi. He travels. Lord, we pray you would break into our longings, into our frustrations, into our stuck and locked up places by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, that you would allow us to open the doors of our lives, to allow your Spirit to come and clean us, Lord, and reveal your word and your truth. And your power and the greatness of who you are. Lord, cut the grass, as it were, we pray, in this place. Lord, come by your Spirit, we pray. Lord, we want to be people who are effective in ministry. We don't want to be people who are just working and doing good things, which is great. But Lord, we want to see the cutting edge, as it were, of your Spirit at work, cutting through things that need to be cut through, Lord. Father, we want to pray that you would prune us and that you would change us and that you would renew us in the likeness of Jesus Christ. Lord, come among us, we pray. So many prayers we could pray this morning. So many longings in our hearts. So many unanswered things. So many sense of disappointment about things that perhaps haven't worked out as we wanted them to. Lord, meet us in the midst of all that stuff. All that stuff, the good, the bad, the indifferent, the boring, the sadness. Lord, we need you. We need you to meet us in our pain. We need you to meet us in our worries and our anxieties. We need you to meet us, Lord, in our places where we have lost faith because we've waited so long for something to happen. Lord, please come and meet us by the power of your Spirit, we pray. Lord, we're longing for you to do something in us that we can't do ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. And Lord, now as we listen to Rick and what he has to bring to us, we pray, Father, that we would be attentive to what you want to say to us this morning and enable us by the power of your Spirit to apply it to our lives and our hearts and our work together here. In Jesus' name, amen. So it's great to welcome our friend Rick. He's been here many times, but of course COVID has meant he hasn't been here for a little while. It's been lovely to be with him this weekend, and he's been with the leadership team for a while, meeting us all and together and as individuals. And now he's going to come and speak to the church. So bless you.
Great.
Amen.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you. Thank you very much, Jonathan. And thank you, Chris and team. Isn't that great, the worship that they've led for us this morning? Really, really appreciate that. Jonathan has asked me this morning to speak about something to do with change and transition. And it's got me thinking about lots of changes over the years. The first time that I was connected with this church was, of course, through Jonathan. He's my primary friendship. I am a friend of the church, but I'm actually Jonathan's friend first. It was back in 1999, and I think you started with this church in 93?
I've been here 29 and a half years. Yeah. My maths is rubbish.
Yeah, so I think you'd been the pastor here for about 6 years anyway. And off and on, I've sort of been back and forth from Australia over that period. So yeah, a long time. Changes coming up for Jonathan. Some of which has been outlined, some of which is still remains unclear and uncertain. That's okay, we move forward. But, you know, come September, Jonathan, you'll be stepping back a couple of days less in time here. Nick will be stepping up into 2 days and taking some of those responsibilities, and we roll it out and see how things work out over the next couple of years beyond that. At the same time, as Jonathan and the church leadership here are dealing with change and transition, I am too. There's a kind of a poignancy being here this morning. I don't know whether I'll be back. Maybe, but for many years I've been travelling back and forth between Australia and the UK, doing work here about 3 times a year. But COVID really caused me to think, okay, what are we doing here? Maybe that it's time for that to stop. And I will say, look, I'm not that old. I'm not as old as Jeff. but, you know, there comes a time when the season changes. And so nothing lasts forever. Here, anyway. In the age to come, it will. So change and transition. Yeah, there's a lot of change going on. And I wonder what sort of changes are happening for you. I mean, you're part of this church, so there's kind of a change that you are involved in here. But there's other kinds of changes, too, that sometimes they're good. Some changes that we choose, we actively choose, they can be really welcome. When you're getting out of a situation that you've wanted to be out of for a while, and that change is like, that's really good. But it's not that kind of change I want to address this morning. It's the kind of change and transition that just gets thrust upon you, and you've just got to cope with it. And that kind of change can cause unsettledness. You're uncertain. You don't know where things are going. I wonder if you're in that kind of place this morning, that there's something going on that's like it's up in the air and you don't really know where it's going to land. Those sort of changes can There's an upside and there's a downside to that. The downside is that change often causes anxiety. The the uncertainty and unsettledness of things not being, you know, calm and sure, they arouse feelings of anxiety. And anxiety isn't just a feeling. You know, there's something that physically takes place in your body when you're anxious. Stuff gets released that goes all around your nervous system. And so you're not just making this up. It's not just imaginary. This is physical stuff that happens in your body. And there are some predictable things. There's things that we know about how humans react in anxiety. Some of the very well-known effects of anxiety are things like this. It decreases your capacity to learn when you're anxious. Because it replaces curiosity with a demand for certainty. It's, do you know that feeling where things are uncertain, they're unsure, and you just want them to be sure. You're desperate. Come on. I just need to have this settled somehow. Because being up in the air is killing you. You know that feeling? Anxiety will do that to you. And so in that moment, we're not open to learning. All the creativity just gets sucked out. It tends to stiffen our position over against other people's positions. You know, when you're anxious and you're in a disagreement with someone, it's like there's not a lot of civility around those conversations sometimes. People just get stuck in their opinion and the other person has another opinion and it's on. You know, we live in anxious times. And boy, there's a lot of evidence of that kind of thing going on. The polarization that's around a whole lot of issues. People, they get stiff in their position. It interrupts our concentration. That's what anxiety will do. And when you're anxious, everything that you try to do, like a mental task, it just takes longer. It's like your brain won't work. You're trying to get through stuff and it just doesn't work as effectively. It floods our nervous system so that we can't hear what's being said to us without distortion. You know, you hear what you think is going to be said rather than what's really being said. And then when you try to express yourself, when you're anxious, it's really hard to get the words to properly convey what you want to convey. Anxiety simplifies our ways of thinking into yes, no. Either or, black, white. There's this, it just becomes a binary, it's kind of a choice. It prompts the desire for a quick fix. Let's get a shortcut. Let's get this done. It arouses feelings of helplessness and self-doubt. It can lead to a whole array of self-defensive behaviours. Because you don't want to get hurt when you're anxious. You're trying to stave all that off. And some of those defensive behaviours can be really harmful to relationships. It diminishes our flexibility in response to life's challenges. We've just got our ways of doing things. And it creates this imaginative gridlock that we can't think of alternatives. We can't think of new perspectives, new alternatives. So anxiety, it has its uses. What it does, it makes us ready to either, the fight or flight. Anxiety, well, you see people when they're anxious, they either retreat or they over-engage. You're like, oh, this is too much. I'm running away, I'm hiding, I'm building a wall, or I'm going to control this. And they over-engage and they meddle around. So that's the downside of change and transition and all the anxiety that it can produce and those kind of human reactions. But there really is some positive potential. In times of change and transition, when things are unsettled and uncertain and all up in the air, you know, God can do some really good work in our character in those times. It's a really rich time of growing in faith and in hope and in love. The kind of character things that God is looking for in us. When you really don't know where things are going, where is it going to land? Boy, your faith gets tested. And it can get a lot stronger in a time of change and transition. Your hope is because that's what you're hanging on to. It's not actually hope in a particular outcome. What we learn to do is to have true Christian hope, which is not hope in an outcome, but hope in a Saviour. Hope in our Lord, in a personal God who's got us. And love. Boy, when we're in change and transition and unsettled and uncertain and all, you know, jigged about, it really tests our love for other people. And I'd say not only our capacity to give love, but our capacity to receive love. So it's actually, it's a moment to turn to God and say, Lord, let this be for good. Don't let this change and transition so uproot me from the good work that you've already begun to do in my life that I lose the plot. Keep me on track, Lord. Use this time to do some work in my life to build me to be the kind of person that you want me to be. We can choose how we respond to contexts of change, especially when there's a lack of clarity about where things are going. Our natural broken responses might lead to disintegration and despair, but God offers us the grace to develop those beautiful character qualities of faith and hope and love. So I'm thinking about what text I could bring. And a lot of the texts that I was thinking about change really are speaking to leaders about how to manage change. And I dwell in those texts quite a bit. But the Lord really directed my attention to this text because it was written to some people who were dealing with change and unsettledness and uncertainty. This is to some people who are, you know, culturally very different to us, but I think there are some similarities in their situation and ours, and we can learn a lot. This is coming at the end of Hebrews, and it's a prayer of blessing, actually, but let's just read it. I'll read it to you. So the writer of Hebrews, we don't know who that writer was, so when I keep on saying the writer of Hebrews, it's because who knows? Now, may the God of peace, and then he has a little parenthesis, he's going to say something about the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep. It's kind of like, we're going to come to the God of peace, but this is also a God of power, you know, who can raise someone from the dead. So this prayer of blessing has got some grunt behind it. You know, this is not just we're coming to some fairy tale God. This is the God of peace and the God of power. Now, may the God of peace equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I think what God wants me to say to you in a nutshell is, look, in a time of change and transition, don't get the wobbles. Keep the main thing the main thing. Do his will. Simple, trusting obedience to God. Because when you're all up in the air and things are a bit uncertain, you can start to get distracted. You can start to want to control things. You're like, settle down, just keep the main thing the main thing. God's got this. He's the God of peace. Reading Hebrews is a little bit like listening into a conversation that, while it doesn't directly involve us, is really interesting because it's kind of relevant. The original recipients of this letter were ethnic Jews in the first century, and they were having a really, really tough time. Look, I'm actually not going to go through all this stuff, but the first point is really the main one to get out. The writer to the Hebrews is saying to these ethnic Jews who are really wondering whether they're on the right track at all, he's saying, no, you have chosen well. You've chosen to follow Jesus. Don't deviate from that. He is the key. And right at the end of the letter, he's coming back and he's praying his prayer of blessing over them. He's reminding them, yep, this God of peace, he's the one who raised Jesus from the dead. And Jesus is the great shepherd of the sheep. So you're in a good sheepfold. Don't be deviated from that. So this simple message, in the core of this, is this bit about doing his will. Now, when we get to that, doing his will, there's a couple of things that make this not quite so easy. The first thing is that there can be some uncertainty in us about, well, what is God's will? Particularly in a time of change when things are moving around and it's unsettled. So what am I supposed to be doing? And then the second question is, well, even if I do know what God's will is, I'm out of my depth. I'm struggling here. I really need some help to actually do that. So I want to look at each of those things. The first one briefly, and the second question a bit more in depth. The first thing, what is God's will? Well, firstly, there's no avoiding the hard work that has to be done in discerning what God is calling you to do. And I can't stand up here and tell you that. It would be wrong to even try. Nobody else can tell you exactly the specifics of what God has called you to do. You need to figure that out for yourself. He's going to give you help to figure it out, and we'll get to that in just a moment. But there are some basic things which are really, really clear. So let's not overcomplicate this. The basics of what God's will is are not complicated. We can go to Micah 6:8, which says, the text says this, he has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? This is the question we're wrestling with. What does the Lord require of me? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. That's not that hard to remember, is it? Act justly. Love mercy. Walk humbly with God. It's pretty simple. Now, the way you work that out in specific situations, you know, there's so much more to think about. So how does that apply? But, you know, the basics, they're there. So we don't need to be confused. When Jesus was asked about what are the most important commandments, he boils down the whole of the Bible into two things. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second one, love your neighbour as yourself. Again, it's not really hard to remember, is it? Love God, love people. So we've got these really easy to remember things that we can hang on to. What's God's will? What am I supposed to do? Well, yeah, it's the obvious. Do that. For me personally, when I'm trying to figure out in this particular situation what would be the right thing to do, I actually go to John chapter 1, where it talks about Jesus came full of grace and truth. All the way through the Gospels, you see, that is that's what Jesus is on about, grace and truth, grace and truth. I think I might have actually spoken about this here once before. It's a grid that's been very important for me and continues to be very, very useful. What is the gracious thing to do here in this situation? And what's the truthful thing? If I'm going to follow Jesus, they're the two things that I really always need to keep in mind. Grace and truth. I can't compromise on either of them. I did last night. I told the truth about... No. Carry on. Well, it's a private joke, sorry. So what is God's will? Yes, the individual thing for you, you're going to have to do a bit of work on that, but the basics are not complicated. The bit that I want to spend a bit more time on now is looking at how we get help and support from God. And this prayer of blessing that's being prayed by the writer to the Hebrews at the end of this letter gives us four things that are resources from God that help us in a time of unsettledness and uncertainty where there's all this change going on, that really help us to keep the main thing the main thing. So the writer of the Hebrews knows that the people he's writing to are going to feel like, I'm out of my depth here. So he's backing up his call to obedience with these four supports. They're coming to the God of peace. You may not be feeling a lot of peace, but you're coming to the God of peace. He himself is your first huge, major resource in order to keep the main thing, and keep your feet in the midst of change. He's the God of peace. Second thing, he's praying that God will equip them. That equipping means that they're not going to be caught short of what they need in order to do God's will. The third thing, he's praying that God will do a transformative work within them. This isn't, so this, you can see how that's different from equipping. Equipping is sort of resources that you get to be obedient, but the transformation is changing who you are. I better not touch that thing, did I? And then the fourth thing is reminding them of their glorious hope that their Lord and Master is going to be forever glorified. There is a forever and ever age to come that they can hang on to in the here and now. So I just want to take each of those things. The peace. We're coming to the God of peace. When you're anxious, that God is the God of peace is a huge comfort. That aspect of his character. It's a special sort of peace. The Hebrew word for peace is shalom. You probably know that. Shalom is, it's not just the absence of war. And we prayed for peace today in Ukraine, and yes, it does include the absence of war, but it's much more than that. It's wholeness, completeness, harmony, well-being, real calm. But when we come to this resource, that we're coming to the God of peace, I wonder if you, like me, have this thought that actually a fair chunk of the unsettledness in my life is caused by following God. That I could actually make life a bit easier for myself and settle things down if I just went with the flow. Does that's kind of ring true to you? You could have an easier time in this life if you just didn't make a fuss about what's gracious and what's truthful and, you know, acting justly and loving mercy and walking humbly. Well, if you just backed off that, you could calm things down a bit. And when you get really keen about saying, I am going to stand for God, I'm going to make him the center of my life and really be intent about that, it kind of attracts a bit of unsettledness. Okay, so how do we resolve that? Jesus talked about this and in John 16, this is his conversation with his disciples at the Last Supper. He says, I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. So the peace that God gives is it's a gift that starts on the inside. And one day, it will work its way to the outside into all of our circumstances, but not yet. That day has not come yet, but it will. But the peace that God gives us now starts on the inside. We come to the God of peace. We receive the peace of God. And it's an inner thing that works its way out. I love that song. From the inside out, Lord, my heart cries out. That's the way the gospel works in our lives. From the inside out. You know, the gift of peace is actually God himself. It's not something that he gives separately to himself. He himself is our peace. It's his living presence, his Holy Spirit that comes to take up residence within our soul. That's the peace. You actually can't have the peace of God without the God of peace. It's him. So the first thing in a time of change and transition, when that change is not just a happy thing for you, but it's a bit of a disturbing thing, when it becomes unsettling, when the uncertainty really starts to rattle you a bit, press into the God of peace. Find Him. It's in your relationship with Him, your connectedness with Him. That's what will calm things down. And that's the first thing that you need, is to actually find that calm in relationship with Him. The second blessing that this prayer is giving to us, the assurance, is that the equipping will be there. Everything good will be given to you so that you can do His will. And that's what you'd expect, everything good, from a God of peace, of shalom, of completeness and wholeness. You know, there's a story back in the ancient times of the people of Israel, where they were in Egypt. They were slaves, and they were required to make bricks for all of the great building programs that the pharaohs had going. And these were bricks that were made from clay and straw. So they'd get the mud clay, mix it around with some straw, pat it into a shape, a standard shape, put it aside, it would dry. And because of the straw, there would be integrity in the brick. It wouldn't just fall apart. You could build stuff with it. But the demands for the amount of bricks that the Hebrews had to make was just climbing and climbing, and was unrealistic. If you're in manufacturing at all, you might know a little bit about bosses requiring more to be done in less time. So there was an outcry, and the slaves, the Hebrew slaves, just said, "Look, we can't do this." Well, the Pharaoh's response was, "You're just lazy. I tell you what, you've had clay and straw to make these bricks in the past. Well, now you'll have to go and get your own straw. We'll give you the clay, but you're going to have to do some extra work because you're lazy. So off you go. You're going to have to get your own straw." So they didn't even have the supply of the basic ingredients that they needed to produce what needed to be produced. That's where we get, there's that little turn of phrase, you know, trying to make bricks without straw. That's the story where that little turn of phrase comes from, where you're being asked to do something but you don't have the resources to do it. God is not like that. He's not going to ask you to do something and not give you the equipment, the resources that you need to do that thing. So God's equipping comes in lots of forms. It can be your skills and talents and your abilities. It could be your knowledge and experience, what you've been through. It could be the material goods that you own, your finances, maybe your key relationships with people. That's equipping. The connections that you've got. It could be the opportunities that open up through circumstances of your life. There's lots of ways in which God will equip us. And your unique mix of these things is a pretty good clue to God's specific will for your life. You know, I've talked in general terms about, you know, act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with God, love people, act in grace and truth. They're the generalities. But the specific things, what God's calling you to do to be faithful to Him, a really good clue is, well, how have I been equipped? Because God's not going to put a hammer in your hand and ask you to bake a cake. So here's the clue. What have you got? What's in your hand? What's God supplied you with? That's your best clue as to where you should put your energies into being obedient to God's will in your life. The equipment is going to match the task. But you do need to think about that to figure that out. It may not be completely obvious, might be a bit of a process in that. And then, so the next bit about God's transforming work, that really helps there. Because God is not only going to equip us, but He's going to transform our minds and our hearts so that we become the kind of people that can use that equipment. So the first bit of transformation is the transformation of the mind. In Romans 12:2, it says, "Don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is." So you don't have to be naturally clever. What you need to do is to open yourself up to the transformation of your mind by the power of the Holy Spirit so that you can figure out, ah, that's what God wants me to do. It is a spiritual thing. In 1 Corinthians 2, it says, the person without the Spirit doesn't accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness. They can't understand them because they're discerned only through the Spirit. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things. It's by the Spirit of God that you're able to think clearly enough to figure out, ah, this is where I need to go. And God will help you with that. But God not only transforms our mind, he also transforms our heart so that we want to do his will. There's a desire that grows up inside. You know, you already have loads of desires, things that you really want to move towards. Those desires are often around your passions, what you think you'd really like to achieve or the situation you'd like to be in, and there's a kind of an inner drive. That heart, that inner drive or desire towards things that we think are going to be good for us, there are a whole lot of other forces that are going on in our lives at the moment. And I think the huge one is what we might just advertising, consumerism. All the time, like all day, every day, stuff comes at us through the media forming our hearts, telling us, oh, this would be really good for you, you know, or this product or this holiday, all the things. And it's pretty overwhelming. We've really got to push back against that. You know, like, hang on, who are we listening to here? The marketing department? Or are we going to listen to the Spirit of God? Because if we open ourselves up and say, oh, God, form my heart. You shape my desires. I want to want what you want. God can do that transformative work within us. And there's one more support that the writer to Hebrews is going to offer us here, and that's hope. The hope of a glorious future. This is where, once again, the preeminence of Jesus comes out. It's been a theme all the way through Hebrews, but it comes up again right at the end here. May he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. We're a future-oriented people. Yeah, we acknowledge the past and we learn from the past, but really, where are we pinning our destiny? It's in the future. This world is not our home. This world is passing away. It's temporary. We need to be faithful and we need to walk through this world, but it's passing away. The day is approaching when the glory of Jesus and who he is and everything that he stands for will be plain for all to see and impossible for anyone to deny. And that future hope really helps us to do God's will, because whatever setbacks you suffer, they're not the end of the story. It doesn't stop here. This too will pass. If you're anxious and unsettled and uncertain and just all messed about, this will pass. It gives us a perspective that, you know, this is temporary, that's eternal. It can develop a deeper joy to know that our future destiny is assured. So we need to hold firm in a season of change. Yes, following Jesus, you are on the right track. He is the key, he is the center. Absolutely crucial. Don't let any kind of change or transition form a wedge between you and the Lord Jesus. Because without him, you're sunk. With him, you're in good space. Hang on to him. Simple, trusting obedience is what he's looking for. It doesn't have to be complicated. The basics of God's will are really pretty plain. Act justly. Love mercy, walk humbly with God, love people, and God will help and support you. I'm going to leave it there, and Jonathan, hand back to you. Let's see what we can do with this and see what the Spirit is stirring within you in terms of your response to that text this morning. Thanks.
So if the guys can get ready as well, just while I'm getting ready. Let's just pray for a minute. I'm going to give opportunity this morning for people who would want prayer to come forward for prayer, just to get yourself measured for that. The idea of coming for prayer is not just about recognizing our need or feeling that somehow there'll be a quick fix to all the issues we're facing. Change doesn't go away. We are in it. We're going through it. But for some of you today, you need to again know that the God of peace is with you. And you also need to know the strengthening or the equipping of God's Holy Spirit to enable you to do the right thing while you're going through change. Now, coming for prayer today is not going to make everything change, but it's part of a process of saying, God, I need you in the change I'm going through, because often I react in a way that is not the way you want me to react. So we're going to pray. Let's pray. Father, help us. We pray that you would come to us in the changes we face in our personal circumstances at this time. That you would be our peace and that you would be our equipper. We pray as a church that you would come to us and enable us at this time of transition to trust you, to keep doing the right things in the right way, to remain faithful and consistent in our service of you, to keep our focus, keep the main thing the main thing. Lord, also, I just want to pray at this time, just before the musicians sing and people come forward, for Tony's son, who is going through a procedure this week. Lord, I want to pray. I don't know if it's Adrian or the other guy, Tony, but I just want to pray peace and blessing upon Tony and upon the family at this time. Also been asked to pray for Iran this morning and the situation, the persecution that's going on there. Lord, in Jesus' name, we pray for your church in Iran. Will you please watch over those dear ones who are struggling and suffering at this time? Will you be their peace and will you equip them with everything that they need at this time? We pray the same for the church in Afghanistan this morning. We pray the same for the church in Ethiopia this morning. We pray the same for the church in Russia and in Ukraine this morning. And as we've prayed for Tony's son, Lord, we bring other members of our church and our family to you who need your touch today. God of shalom, of wholeness, of peace. As we quietly remember names before you now, we pray, come. Come in power, come in healing, come in strength. And equip us, Lord, with those people who we are meeting with and interacting with. Equip us to enable us to bring you into these situations through our words and even in our prayers, Lord, in Jesus' name. So thank you for what you've said to us today, Lord. Help us to respond in the way that you want us to respond, Lord, to actually take this kind of message and apply it to our lives. For me, Lord, help me to do that. For each one in this room and watching, I pray that we would all seriously apply what you want to do in our lives. That, Father, we would be part of a spring clean at the moment, where your word is found and discovered in a new way. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we're going to sing a song, and as we do, if you want prayer, please come forward and we'll pray for you. Thank you.
See his love nailed to a cross, perfect and blameless life given. Sacrifice. See him there, calling the name.
has done it. Death is beaten. Heaven beckons me. Greater love no one could ever show. Mercy so undeserved. Freedom I should not know.
Say the grace together. If you still want prayer, just be aware if we have drinks and teas and coffees, there are people being prayed for, so please be sensitive to that, please, but we'll say the grace together and then we'll close the service off. Thanks for listening. If you've been at home today, God bless you where you are, and thank you for coming this morning. Let's say the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. God bless you. Have a good week. Thank you.